welcome back to Math Teacher Lounge. I'm Bethany Lockhart Johnson.
And I'm Dan Meyer.
And today we are talking about data science. So for me, that's interpreting data, being able to read a graph. We see graphs all around us, taking data and making it make sense for others. We need to talk about this.
Data science is a pretty contested term right now. It has a lot of buzz, very buzzy. We're gonna invite some cool people on to chat about this. But for starters, I just want to know from you, Bethany, what's a graph that's caught your eye recently? Let's do some data right now. What you got?
Well, I feel like the only graphs I'm seeing are related to COVID data. They're related to what people are doing when they're staying at home. They're related to joblessness. They're related to, I mean, just everything is related to in this moment right now with the stay-at-home orders, with COVID. So I do have a graph to show you.
Okay, hold on. Let me see here.
Before you even look at the graph, I need to say I am in no way making light of the pandemic. I am sharing this graph because for me, I'm hoping it resonates with folks who need a way to picture the power of flattening the curve.
This works for me, and it speaks towards the aspect of data science that includes not just the raw data, not just the number crunching, but in particular, the communication of conclusions to audiences in ways that they'll understand. And I recall the flattening the curve graph from very early on during the pandemic, and it made a ton of sense to me that you'd want to, that we're not reducing the total number of infections so much as spreading them out over time. And that made tons of sense. But for a lot of folks, if they don't do data, you know, if they're not data professionals like us math teacher types, I can see how this right here would paint a certain picture,
right,
for them.
You're going to remember flattening the curve. Come on. So again, not making light of the pandemic, but instead using data to help us make sense and make data more memorable. Okay, Dan, I bet you have a graph.
I do have a graph. Okay, check it out. Here's my graph I wanted to share with you. This graph is nowhere near as interesting. It has 100%, 200% fewer kitties on it, sadly. but this is a graph of data that I collected when I was but a new teacher. And I had the question in my head, which checkout line is fastest and how can math help me figure this out? So I went to a local grocery store. I stood there with a clipboard and I started like in a timer and I was timing these poor cashiers.
Did you ask the manager?
I talked to the manager, but not the cashiers. And I presented myself as though I was some, you know, humble local teacher trying to do some math with his students. And he went with it. And I plotted the data and graphed this line through it. And it really blew my mind. Those numbers there, like right there, if you take zero items and you plug it into that equation, you get 41.174 seconds or roughly, you know, 40 seconds or so.
For zero items.
What's going on here? Like, why does that line not go more cleanly through the origin and in unpacking all of this?
Dan, can I tell you something? That this is an example of data that would be really helpful because I am notorious for being the line switcher. Like, I'll be in a line and I'm like, nope, that one. And I'll switch over and it drives my husband crazy. Yeah. He's like, stay where you are. And I'm like, no, we have to move over. So what I'm trying to understand when I look at this, zero items, zero takes 41 seconds. That is hard to believe. So
Yeah, it's impossible, right? Like zero items, just like don't go through the line, right? But this is where math and people meet each other and need that kind of mutual interpretation, knowing the limits of math. And what's that 2.9 mean? That 2.9 right there, roughly 3 is the slope. That's 3 seconds per item. And that makes some sense to me. It's like boop, 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 3 seconds, right? But what's the 41 about? Like, why is there that extra 41 seconds?
I think it's me forgetting my loyalty card and entering the wrong number. And then, could you try this phone number?
Yes.
I think it's that.
Yes. Plus the hi, hello, goodbye, plus payment, you know, catch someone who writes a check. That takes forever. Anyway, all of this is to say, the realization here is that every single person costs 41 seconds in line, which makes the express lane a pretty bad bet.
Ooh.
Like, this is the realization I had that I am sharing with you and only you, Bethany, and hopefully no one else is listening in here, that the express lane is a lie.
although I think the time in line does matter and is something that we probably all take a glance at. I don't know if you're a line switcher like me, but the point is that data matters. And are we actually preparing our kiddos to be able to interpret and make sense of data? I have seen plenty of things in the news that are showing me that most adults aren't actually reading data and making sense of it in a way that's going to help inform their decisions, which is really one of the points.
Yeah, and there's also possibly a perception that data science and interpreting data in general is more of a skill for older students, and we might delay that kind of important work until a time past which it's even all that useful, where it's they've missed out on some really formative experiences with data. And so we're so excited to bring to you folks one of our favorite teachers, coaches of teachers out of Massachusetts, Jenna Laib, who's going to share with us a pedagogical tool for making graphs real and accessible to every student. Welcome to the show, Jenna.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, we're so excited to have you here at the Math Teacher Lounge. And so can you tell us a little bit about the evolution of the slow reveal graph and kind of how your thinking around data science has evolved?
I think I've always been really interested in data. The first time I saw a slow reveal graph done, it was actually by Brian Bouchard, and he had called them numberless graphs. And he had taken a graph and removed all of the contextual information. So it was just bars. And then after revealing that to kids, revealed a little bit more information, maybe what the categories of these different bars were. And then progressively revealed more and more information and encouraged students to talk about it. And so I decided to try it out with my own class. I actually was teaching a sixth grade class at that time. I'm back teaching sixth grade again this year. And it was really fascinating to see how they interacted with it, how they were able to attend to different things when pieces of the graph had been stripped away and decontextualized. And then they then made sense of the context as it kept getting added back. And that they really had such profound noticings that I don't think they would have had if I'd revealed the whole thing to them at the very beginning.
That's fantastic. I think anyone who hears like profound noticings, your words there, is going to be intrigued about how to make that happen with their own students. And as well as this idea of graphs having human features, it's clear you're doing something with graphs and students that is uncommon. Would you just make this concrete for Bethany and I and everyone watching? What is a slow reveal graph? How does this work?
So I'm going to show you one that I've done before with some third and fourth graders. Actually, my very favorite slow reveal graphs tend to be ones that other people make. And there are a lot of ones that involve social justice issues and environmental issues. But I'm going to show you one that is maybe done with some younger kids. So it starts just like this. And we ask the kids, what do you notice about this? And what do you wonder about this? So what are some things that you two are noticing and wondering?
I'm wondering, does each person represent like one person, or is it a scaled graph? Like, it looks like I'm also seeing the repetition of the orange people in like one orange person, and then there's a lot of orange people, you know, very eloquent noticings like that.
No, I'm even hearing you say that like you think that this is a person.
Seems like a person to me. Something about people.
Yeah, I'm noticing colors. I'm noticing that there's seven different rows, and I'm wondering what there is seven of, and my mind goes to continents, which is the only seven thing I know of. But wait, days of the week. I got one more. Yeah, I'm wondering why some of them don't have purple and green. And on a pedagogical level, I'm just noticing I don't feel scared of this, you know. Whereas I just feel like it's open to me, and I'm able to just like share whatever I want to share here, which is fun.
I think the ambiguity and openness at the beginning, like you'll get all sorts of kids talking here that maybe don't ordinarily talk in math class because there's so many different possibilities you could say here.
It's interesting because my reaction was like, oh, maybe my noticing wasn't like eloquent enough, but it's like, no, that's what we want to encourage kids to do is just, what do you notice? Like it can be really broad and open. And like you said, Dan, it's an invitation like to just look and think and, you know, start pondering and without having it all fed to you. So far I'm totally, oh wait. And then in that one row, there's like purple and one blue person.
Yeah, what's the deal with that? None of the other ones have two colors. It's the only one with two colors. So now I'm really wondering what that could represent. And these half people really get the kids, like, what is a half person doing there? And so then you can reveal different things. In this case, we're actually going to reveal the subject of the graph. So here is the title. So this graph, animals causing human deaths in a year.
Got grim. Got real grim.
It got real grim. I will say that teachers have watched me do this one, and they always look horrified when that is revealed. And the kids are like, yes. And they're like, yeah. and we do say that this is not just injury specifically. This is, in fact, deaths. And you can also notice, like, what other things were just revealed to you besides the title?
What the colors mean.
Yeah. And so you can now see what's happening with that purple and that green.
So it's like the person had an allergic reaction to the venom. Is that what that would mean?
What do you think?
That's what I think.
We see a bunch of purple and we see just one of the green. So this is a pictograph. And in pictographs, we're usually using some scale where an icon will represent more than one thing. So yeah, these each represent more than one person. So you can see it's just more purple causes of death than green causes of death.
Oh, got it.
More allergic reactions than venom.
Dan, a little different than your days of the week, huh, Dan?
I was so far off. I could not have been more far off. But I don't feel bad about it. I don't feel bad. Like, there was no wrong answer there.
No, and that was really helpful background knowledge that you were bringing in. And then we can think about, like, what the category, like, what labels we might see here. And actually, with the different colors, you can probably make some predictions. Which animal do you think might be easiest to predict based on the colors?
I think that those green and the green and purple majority ones, I think, have got to be, like, snake and bee. Snake, like,
so bee. Bee.
Like, I think that... Like, the big-time allergic one is probably the bee, but I don't get, like, why bee would have any... Well, I guess... Yeah, it's just interesting how to... Like, if someone died from an allergic reaction to a bee, how did that allergic reaction happen if not through a sting? So, like, that's a tricky one. Venom's got to be snake. Venom has got to be snake right there.
It could be snake scorpion, yeah? Snake.
I will say that the first one is my son's favorite animal, which is the shark, followed by a lion. And then we have
a box of jellyfish. Oh, come on now.
Is that a snake at all?
Not at least in this graph. And then we could progress and show. There we go. That one actually is an elephant. You had mentioned elephants earlier. Now you want to see what this one is.
Yeah.
It is a bee.
It is a bee. And yet, what gives us nightmares? It's the shark. And yet, only one. Well, it's scaled, so it could be more than one, but...
Right, we don't yet know how much each one is represented.
Yeah, yeah.
It makes sense that the shark has half a person, though, since it kind of, like, bites the person in half, right?
Like, that makes sense. In every single elementary class, there was like, does that mean just maybe the leg? I'm like, well, look at the title again.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
They get really into that shark one. This causes lots of discussion. And then we actually have a Cape Buffalo. And we have a hippopotamus.
Hold on.
And then where do you think that big one is at the bottom?
Well, I would have
the
never
human, the human
buffalo,
animal.
So
that also comes up in almost every class.
A dog?
So
oh
deep.
No, not death, just injury. Lion's already up there. What do you think, Dan? Biting, mauling, trampling, or goring?
So many choices.
House cat. I'm going house cat. Final answer.
So I will say that this graph is just a sampling of animals. It comes from a book by Steve Jenkins called Animals by the Number, and that this doesn't necessarily represent the most animal, like the animal that causes the most human death, period. But in this graph, it is a crocodile.
Wow.
Usually students find the hippopotamus the most shocking. We don't hear a lot about hippo deaths. And
they're so cute. Yeah, I don't trust them now, though.
No, it's a lot. So the question is, like, how much is this? And sometimes, like, even in third and fourth grade, kids will start to notice relationships between these, like that the hippopotamus looks like it's about twice as much as the Cape Buffalo. Or you can see that the lion and the box jellyfish look about equal. And that might be kind of surprising. But now I think it's important to dig into, like, what exactly is this data telling us? So, like, we know that the crocodiles cause more deaths, but exactly how many more? So let's think about what each figure represents. So any ideas about what they could represent?
And can I say too that I know that you're speeding it up a little bit for like us and for the viewers, but just even in this like brief amount of time, I've already gotten more invested in this graph than I ever would if you had just put this graph as a like in total with all the parts filled in and given me all the information. Like, it's asking more of me. It's asking me to engage in a different way. And it's asking me to be a little bit more reflective of like, hey, you were pretty confident that was a snake. Well, why? What do I know? What do I already know? And like bringing in these things that, you know, bringing in things that I know or that I wonder about animals. And so I'm like, I'm loving this as a way of like engaging with data. This is really, really powerful.
It ties together the contextual and mathematical knowledge that I have and makes both of them stronger than it would if I saw this right here. It would definitely have the number of figures per year already written up there. It's a more overwhelming presentation that kind of already says, hey, here's the contextual stuff. Skip that. Let's do some math on it now.
And typically in like a textbook, I feel like I would see the graph with everything filled in, and then it would say each figure represents this many deaths per year. How many were killed by a Cape buffalo? And that would be like the extent of the engagement that I was asked, you know, to just engage with the graph, right? Is just by doing that, can I read that element of it? It doesn't ask me to do any of this other work, prediction, questions, notice, wonder, et cetera.
No, and students that are not at all excited to talk about how many more people died from hippopotamuses than Cape buffalo will actually be really excited when they look closely and realize that it's about twice as much. And then they'll get up there and they'll count the number of people and see it's exactly twice as much. They get really invested in these relationships in sophisticated ways.
Is this something that you feel like can work K through 12? Is this something that you've seen? I know you were a coach K-8. So is this something you can see, like any teacher, you would invite them to try something like this?
I've done them in first grade. I actually did some circle graphs in first grade, which is not at all when I would introduce circle graphs ever. I don't like doing them in even middle school, but the kids really got it. They had all sorts of exciting things they wanted to share about it. My brother's actually a high school teacher and he's done it in high school. I think it can be used. You adapt it to your context.
If folks want to know more about your project or you, where can they find you and your work?
So the website that we host is slowrevealgraphs.com, and you'll see some that are already created. But of course, people are welcome to create more or to change how the story is revealed.
I love it. Thank you so much for joining us and lending your voice to this space and helping us to think more critically about data science and about graphing. And hippopotamus. What's the plural? Hippopotami? Thanks so much for joining us for this episode of the Math Teacher Lounge. We want to hear from you. How are you engaging your students with data? What does the exploration of data and representations of data look like in your classroom space? You can email us, mathteacherlounge@gmail.com. You can also find us on Twitter, @MTLShow. We hope you'll also join us on Facebook in our Facebook group, Math Teacher Lounge. It's a perfect space to connect with other educators about topics on this show and see some exclusive content, some of which didn't make it into the episode, but that we can't wait to share with you. Thanks so much for joining us. Bye.